Well, g'day again. Hope you're all well. You better be, because I'm praying for you. So no one's allowed to get sick without permission, all right? Just saying. So we're in the book of Philemon, and we did a little bit of the introduction the other day. And by now you would have read the whole book. Oh my goodness, how many verses? All 25 of them. So we want to just press on and get to know this book a little bit. And see what the Lord might say to us through it, and also learn how to actually handle a book. So look, here's a trip. If slavery was bad, why did Philemon, first of all, why did he have a slave? But then why did Paul not say to Philemon, you shouldn't have had a slave anyway, who do you think you are? You know? So I've got to ask the question, if slavery is not part of the gospel, then why did Paul not attack the very essence of slavery right at the beginning? I think that's a pretty fair question. But here's a thought. Often a revolution just starts with one person, and it spreads from there, and it goes out into the culture. And so I think Paul here is writing a masterful piece of work, and he's going to start a revolution that will be used right up into the slavery in the United States, and Wilberforce and all those guys referred back to this book about the need to treat one another as brothers in Christ. So instead of just wiping slavery altogether, he has this amazing letter that he writes. So I'm not going to read every bit of it with you, but I'm going to read bits and pieces. So as Paul's kind of maneuvering his way through this difficulty, because now he's got Onesimus, who was a runaway slave, who used to belong to Philemon, Paul's mate, and now he's sending Philemon back with a letter from himself to ask for mercy and grace. So I do hope Philemon read the letter before he punished the runaway slave. But here's what Paul says. Your love has impacted me and brings me great joy and encouragement. And you have encouraged and refreshed the hearts of others through you, brother. So Paul is actually emphasizing that you are an example to us all. You are the man. We are so excited to know you, Philemon, because you have refreshed us and you have encouraged us. And then he goes on with his request about Onesimus. And he says, I could be really bold and say to you, Philemon, just let the man go. But rather than that, he says, I appeal to you. I love it. I appeal to you, rather, because of our great friendship. And then he goes on to say, and here am I, an old man. Now, Paul at this stage would have been about 60, so 60-ish. So that's not all that old, but he's really emphasizing, first of all, his right as an apostle to have commanded him. But now he's saying not only that, but I'm an old man, and this Onesimus became my son in the faith when I was imprisoned in chains. And so now, as an old man who has fathered Onesimus during this time, I appeal to you as my friend to consider what I am saying. He says, and I'm now at verse 11. Let me read it. Formerly he was not useful or valuable to you, but now he is valuable to both of us. So this runaway slave, he was of no use to you. He was probably a pain in the neck. But now he's useful to both of us. And what Paul is doing is he is actually punning on the name Onesimus, because Onesimus means useful. And he's saying, formerly he was not Onesimus to you. He was not useful to you, but now he's become a real Onesimus. He's become a real useful one to both of us. And from my heart, I'm sending him back to you. I bet this slave is pretty nervous, like I would be. And Paul goes on to say, and I'm now in verse 13, you know, I would have actually preferred to keep him at my side so that he could have taken your place in helping me at this time. See how Paul's kind of maneuvering his way to get into the heart of Philemon. He says, however, I did not want to make this decision without your consent. I want you to be a part of it. I'm going to use you to be the example to everyone about how to treat runaway slaves. It is a revolution that Paul is starting in a very quiet, gentle way. People are going to talk about what Philemon has done. He says, so I'm going to ask you so that your act of kindness and willingness would be obvious to others. So, perhaps you could think of it in this way, Paul says. He was separated from you for a time so that you could have him back forever. And you could welcome him, but no longer as a slave, but as a brother in Christ, a dearly beloved brother. I love this. And he is that to me especially, and how much more to you, both humanly speaking and in the Lord. So this is an amazing little section of the word. We're not finished yet. I'll do another session. But I want you to understand the heart of Paul, the way a revolution happens, that slavery never was and never is compatible with the message of the kingdom of God, and that we don't always have to fight things head on, but that there are subtle ways through with prayer and the declaration of the word and getting into the hearts of people that we can actually change the perception and the perspective of a whole culture. Okay, I'll be back with you sometime.